When Julian arrived at the base, he was whisked away to General Brody's office. Escorted by armed guards, he realized he had underestimated the military's seriousness about the alleged offense, and their pride. The guards brought him in, and Brody waved them out of the room. "Dr. Rose, we meet again," the general smiled as he shook Julian's hand. "Have a seat. It appears our Jade has gotten herself into a bit of trouble." Julian sat. "I've already told the marshals I don't know where she is."
I know,
Brody calmed him. "But we need to talk to you, if just to satisfy the Army investigators," he winked. "General, I believe she can explain this whole thing if they'd just give her a chance. You understand that this was as big a surprise to me as it was to you?" Brody smiled. "I know the story, a brilliant mind blinded by love. It's okay, don't worry, I have to tell you. The pressure's off now that the final device is on its way to the Sea of Japan. Your boss, Dr. Paradine, has had to swallow his pride and make the adjustments that our lovely and brilliant Jade told us we needed to make. The final test is day after tomorrow." Julian jumped up with a passionate plea. "General, we can't detonate that bomb into the atmosphere. It has the old design that puts the ozone layer at great risk for shearing. We have to stop it."
"Dr. Rose, this is out of my hands."
"It's out of your hands, beyond any of our control. Even if Oppenheimer wanted to stop this test, it would still go on. That's because the powers in the Pentagon have absolute control over decisions in this war, and they are determined to cut it off with this gadget as soon as possible. And they have convinced Truman. So let's just don't waste any more breath on it." This is an author's note. This test used an implosion-designed plutonium device, informally nicknamed the Gadget, of the same design as the Fat Man bomb, later detonated over Nagasaki, Japan on August 9, 1945. The complexity of the design required a major effort from the Los Alamos Laboratory, and concerns about whether it would work led to a decision to conduct the first nuclear test. General Brody went on. "You've been under surveillance for the last few weeks as a precautionary measure, and not the least of which because you pointed out some problems, and were considered a bit of a troublemaker, a worrywart by that sourpuss Paradine. But your non-involvement has been proven many times over. You're not currently under suspicion by the U.S. Army Air Corps."
"Maybe I ought to be."
The general brushed this off. "I have to ask for myself, though. Ms. Velasquez didn't do anything dangerous to anyone. More like mischief, so I'm just curious. Why do you think she would risk the wrath of the Army just to cause a few short delays in an inevitable project?" Julian had a ready answer. "It's obvious she thought the prevailing design was dangerous. I would say she was so sure that it was potentially harmful, harmful to Earth beyond its power to kill, that she took action. A woman of courage and conviction, wouldn't you say?" Julian offered. "But as far as how she arrived at her conviction, I can't quite fathom it either. I mean, she was questioning the brightest minds on the planet with her calculations. What kind of person has the courage to do that? She's amazing."
"There's that word again."
"Never mind, General. We just need to focus on the coming test at Trinity. I say again, it must be postponed until further adjustments can be made." Brody was being very patient. "I'm afraid that isn't going to happen. The pressure for producing this weapon is greater than ever. We didn't need the bomb to beat the Germans, that's one thing. Jade's delay made no difference there, but as we speak, preparations are being made for a Japanese land invasion. It will be a terrible battle, worse than Normandy. If we can prevent it in any way, we will. The A-bomb is our best bet for saving a million lives in lieu of a land invasion. Too bad it will cost some civilian casualties, but we have to look at the big picture. Only when the enemy sees they can't protect their wives and children will they surrender. It will be horrific, but the alternative is worse. Truman has already given the order, and he has to live with it. There's no one to buck him, and the Congress is 100% behind him." Julian took this very hard. He nodded, finally getting it, and sat down again. General Brody spoke to him firmly. "Son, you're not a trained soldier. Your work is helping people. Saving lives is your reason for being, and I know this has got to be hard for you. But there isn't one thing we can do about either one of these bombs going off, and we're going to have to come to a reckoning. I can't imagine what you're thinking right now with your worry about Jade, your fear of the skies being ripped apart, and the thought that your work, if it's successful, is about to take thousands of innocent lives, even if they are the enemy." Julian was listening, and Brody continued, "But the fact is, there won't be much humanity left to breathe that atmosphere if we don't put an end to this madness of a war soon. I tell you true, I don't believe there's any power on Earth short of Harry Truman's signature that can stop that bomb from going off in 3 days." They were quiet for a while. Outside the windows of the office, Julian looked up and watched what looked like the entire base packing up to travel to Socorro, the jumping-off place for Trinity site. Then he looked up into the mountains beyond the base. He thought of Jade camping in the mountains above Ranchos de Taos, and a thought was born. "I may know something more powerful than Harry Truman's signature, and she's amazing." Jade, perched on a ridgetop, looking up toward the high country above the pueblo known as Wheeler Peak Wilderness. It was mid-morning, and she had been given permission by Taos Pueblo Governor Tony Lujan to travel into the sacred Blue Lake area, usually restricted to Taos Pueblo inhabitants. She started up the path toward the lake even before the sun topped the ridges. She was leaving behind the magpies and the meadowlarks, and entering into the realms of the red-tailed hawk and the eagle. Tony's response when she asked permission surprised even her. She had known him, her earthly memory as Jade, that is, since she was a little girl and walked with his daughters on Taos Pueblo lands. He had said, "Yes, of course you may ride on our lands. Be aware that revelations are common in the Blue Lake. That is where our young warriors go for their visions," he grinned. "In fact, I was told in a dream that you were coming. Now you must listen. My dream said you must go to the mountain and seek your own vision, but stay only for 2 days. On the third day, you must return." She thanked him and turned up the mountain path, reached down and patted Borrasca, then set off upward to Blue Lake. She would seek her vision at nightfall on the lake shore, 11,500 feet above sea level. Dr. Rose spent all his waking hours the next 2 days trying to get someone, anyone, to listen. But all around him, closures were being made, offices vacated, and project workers were heading south to the Trinity test site. For most part, they were convinced that the work was finished. It was generally known that this test was primarily for the publicity and an opportunity for the U.S. military to show off its muscle. It seemed that everyone who had missed the first test was determined to see the second. Truth was, no one was remotely interested in listening to the warning of Dr. Julian Rose. At the end of the second day, he gave up in frustration. "I have to find Jade. If she returns, even at the risk of court-martial, perhaps General Brody can convince Oppenheimer that the test is a bad idea." He resolved to drive back to Taos the next morning to try to find Jade. If they wanted to follow him, then let them. He didn't believe they would bother.